in the media conference with Lal Goyal, which is brought to you by V4 News, Global TV, V4 Stream, Malnadu TV, News Gaon Se, Samvad Sarokar News, Organ Donation India Foundation and Gyan. Our endeavor is to enlighten you with the current topics. And today's topic is very, very current, relevant, controversial, but very much required. And the topic is sexual harassment, skin-to-skin contact. A recent judgment delivered by a single judge of the Bombay High Court at Nagpur in the case of Satish versus the State of Maharashtra in the criminal appeal number 161/2020 is a classic example of incorrect application of the law and reeks of judicial insensitivity to the larger issue of child abuse. By requiring skin-to-skin contact as an essential ingredient for sexual assault, the learned judge has stirred a hornet's nest. By corollary, usage of gloves would be a good defense against criminal liability. Similarly, usage of condom by a rapist would save him from charge of rape. It will not be surprising if ingenious criminals took this as a precedent to seek protection against all cases where physical contact is required to invoke the necessary presence of skin-to-skin contact to constitute touch. The term sexual assault has been defined under Section 7 of the Protection of Children Against Sexual Offence Act 2012, POSCO, as whoever with sexual intent touches the vagina, penis, anus, or breast of the child or makes the child touch the vagina, penis, anus, or breast of such person or any other person or does any other act which involves physical contact without penetration is said to commit sexual assault. Thus, an analysis of the section requires the presence of following essential ingredients to prove sexual assault. Act of accused to be done with sexual intent. This implies that an accused cannot be held guilty for accidental or involuntary acts. Any one or more of the following: physically touching the vagina, penis, anus, or breast of the child, or making the child touch the vagina, penis, anus, or breast of any person, or any other act which involves physical contact without penetration. The language is clear that in order to constitute sexual assault, there must be physical touch or contact. However, the law does not specify whether the touch has to be necessarily skin to skin. This interpretation was left to the wisdom of the judiciary, who were expected to do so in the light of the legislative intent, which may be deciphered from the title as well as the statement of objects and reasons behind the enactment of such law. Penetration is not required to constitute sexual assault and constitutes a separate category of sexual assault termed as penetrative sexual assault, defined under Section 3 of POSCO. There is an obligation mentioned under UNCRC and expressly reiterated in the statements of objects and reasons to POSCO that obligates us to undertake all measures to prevent the inducement or coercion of a child to engage in any unlawful sexual activity. Section 354 of the Indian Penal Code, 1860, as amended in 2013, states, whoever assaults or uses criminal force to any woman intending to outrage or knowing it to be likely that he will thereby outrage her modesty shall be punished with imprisonment of either description for a term which shall not be less than 1 year, but which may extend to 5 years, and shall also be liable to fine. This provision was used to cover incidences of molestation as distinguished from eve teasing covered under Section 509. While the latter covers incidents where the woman has been insulted, teased, or her privacy intruded upon from a distance, Section 354 required the usage of some criminal force against a woman deliberately with an intent to outrage her modesty. Modesty was defined in judgments as an essential attribute of womanhood present in every woman, irrespective of her age. The use of criminal force required under Section 354 also did not specify the force to necessarily require skin-to-skin contact. On January 27, a bench led by Chief Justice Bobde stayed one of the two judgments which said that groping a minor over her clothes does not amount to sexual assault under the POCSO Act. The stay came on an urgent oral mentioning made by Attorney General K.K. Venugopal, who said the judgment would set a dangerous precedent and cripple the very intention of the POCSO law to protect children from sexual offenders. The second judgment by Justice Gandiwala concluded that holding hands with a five-year-old girl and unzipping the trousers did not amount to sexual assault under the POCSO Act. In one more case, she reversed a lower court order convicting a 23-year-old accused of rape of a minor on the grounds that the testimony did not inspire confidence and was not of sterling quality. She also said the birth certificate of the minor was not verified. The judgments have raised questions about the judge's handling of POCSO cases. In all three cases, accused convicted under the POCSO Act were acquitted by her. Chief Justice of India, CJI Sharad A. Bobde, wrote to the government withdrawing the Supreme Court Collegium's recommendation to appoint Justice P.V. Gandiwala, an additional judge of the Bombay High Court, as permanent judge following her controversial decisions in two sexual assault cases. The file on Justice Gandiwala will now be placed before the Collegium for a decision on her tenure as additional judge. Justice Gandiwala's judgment has raised objections within the judiciary itself, a source said. The Collegium had recommended her appointment as permanent judge only on January 20th, 2021. Justice Pushpa Virendra Gandiwala is a sitting additional judge of the Bombay High Court in Maharashtra. She had adjudicated a number of cases concerning the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic. Justice Gandiwala, B.Com, LLB, LLM, initially practiced law in Amravati District Court and has also lectured on law at Amravati University. Justice Gandiwala was appointed as a district judge in 2007 and served on the City Civil Court in Mumbai and the District and Family Courts in Nagpur. She later became the principal district and sessions judge in Nagpur and subsequently was appointed as the Registrar General of the Bombay High Court. In 2018, Justice Gandiwala was one of the several judges who were considered for appointment to the Bombay High Court but was not appointed after the Bombay High Court recommended against it. The Supreme Court of India accepted the Bombay High Court's adverse recommendations and decided to defer consideration of her appointment. In 2019, Justice Gandiwala's appointment was reconsidered and she was appointed as an additional judge in the Bombay High Court. She is currently posted to the Nagpur bench of the Bombay High Court. Justice Gandiwala's name was sent on 20th November 2017 to the top court by the Bombay High Court for elevation. She figured in the list of six district judges from Maharashtra who were deemed fit to become judges of the High Court. As per media reports, two Supreme Court judges who had objected to Gandiwala's name had provided a detailed analysis in 2017-18 of the judgments she had authored in the trial courts to demonstrate her lack of knowledge of the law. However, the Collegium disregarded the reservation expressed by the two judges then and proceeds her appointment. At a meeting of the Collegium on 16th January 2019, Justice Gandiwala's name was cleared for appointment as a judge of the Bombay High Court. So today's topic, which is sexual harassment, skin to skin contact, we have an elite, learned panel with us. And I would like to introduce my first guest, and she is Ms. Bhamati IAS. Ms. Bhamati is the former Secretary, Government of India. She belongs to the 1979 batch IAS of the Bihar cadre. After retirement, she joined the Central Administrative Tribunal in October 2013. Hailing from Tamil Nadu, she holds master's degree in English Literature and Rural Development, MPhil degree in Women Studies, and an MBA in Disaster Management. Besides serving in Government of Bihar in various capacities, she has served in the Government of India in the Ministry of Home Affairs, the Ministry of Rural Development, Panchayati Raj, Drinking Water and Sanitation, Land Resources, and Ministry of Women and Child Development Department. She also worked with bilateral and multilateral bodies such as UNICEF, DANIDA, UNFPA, and UNDP, Regional Office of South and Southeast Asia, on issues such as gender, reproductive health, female pesticide, population policies, HIV/AIDS, unsafe mobility, including trafficking and migration. She has worked over the last three decades on the issue of anti-human trafficking and worked very closely with NGOs and civil society partners, various commissions for women, human rights and child rights at the center and in the states. In collaboration with the Chief Justice, has organized judicial collegio on human trafficking in several states during 2010 and 2012. On a directive of the Honorable Chief Justice of India, in 2012, she has assisted the Apex Court as an expert in a matter relating to anti-human trafficking in Buddhadev Karmaskar versus Union of India. She has written and published materials in her areas of expertise. Recently, she has been awarded with the Lifetime Achievement Award for contribution to combat human trafficking in India by the US Consul General, Kolkata. She has been widely consulted by government, NGOs, United Nations, and multilateral bodies nationally and internationally. And moreover, she has also pledged to donate her all the organs. Welcome, Ms. Bhamati, on our show. Ms. Bhamati, as you know, that there is not only one, but there are three judgments has come in this month, the last month only. Although one judgment has been stayed by the Supreme Court, and the recommendation of her, which has been sent by earlier by the Supreme Court for making her permanent High Court judge, has been withdrawn. And now again, the collegium will decide whether she will continue as an additional judge in the High Court judge, or she will revert back as a district judge. So we would like to know about the particular judgments and your views about the sexual harassment, skin-to-skin contact. Ms. Bhamati, please.
Namaskar, Mr. Goyal. Thank you for your kind introduction and for the prefatory remarks that you've given about the background of this case and the manner in which the judge has come up to this level despite objections, despite people not having recommended to her. So this is a something very shocking revelation for many of us. I was personally not aware of these facts. Now, notwithstanding that, I want, there's nothing personal about what I have to say in this forum. Nobody is infallible. People do make mistakes. But this pertains to a case which has shocked the collective conscience of the nation by a lady judge. I'm coming to the qualifying use of the word lady much later. Now, you've also mentioned about these other judgments, three or four judgments, three in close heels, coming in close heels, one a little later, all of which have to be looked at holistically when we talk about this matter that you have rightly raised today. Now, the definition of sexual assault, as you read out from the Act, the judgment amounts to saying that subject to the condition that somebody is wearing clothes and not nude, then only the skin to skin contact will apply. This is absolutely perverse and absolutely outrageous. Absolutely perverse and absolutely outrageous. Now, she has also taken body contact. The judge has taken body contact literally and taken the body with the skin included and clothes excluded. I don't know how these things happen. We have to understand, go by the spirit of the law and not the letter of the law. It is presumed that all these tactile offenses happen when people are wearing clothes and when it is not when it's just torn or lifted, etc., etc. This is not the job of the court to do. It is for whether you belong to the judicial fraternity or outside, it is understood that this constitutes a bad touch. And that's how the law has been framed. Now, having said that, the whole purpose of this discussion would be to ensure that corrective actions are taken and such people are not allowed to run the law or be abroad, you know, much as predators are put into jails. So we have to look at that. And we are also looking at this issue from the point of view that we are talking about children who have no voice, and it is the responsibility of adults to protect them from any violation of their rights. Therefore, you can't look the other way. And Mr. Goyal, you've done the right thing by not making everybody look the other way. There is a lot of petition signing that has happened, which I have subscribed and I have shared with everybody. And I think this is the right way to approach the issue, to talk about it, make it an important point of public discourse, and to bring out the problems that this judgment has, this and other judgments from the same, originating from the same source. Now, the point is, we need to look at the psyche of the judge who has given this judgment. The skin to skin contact, which is under discussion. In the other case, she said that she let off the offender by saying that there was no evidence of scuffle or resistance from the victim. This is despite the fact that the Supreme Court has passed several judgments in this respect. We go by judicial precedence. Now, unwittingly and unwarranted, she also mentioned that the age of the child in another case, that the age of the child was 17 years and 9 months. And she has also admitted, as you have said, that she did not verify the age. Now, for a judge to have consistently, and I will use the word habitually, pass judgments which hurts the human conscience, collective conscience, but it also hurts all laws that the judge is supposed to abide by, the rulings that the judge is supposed to abide by. Not having gone through all this, how could a person be elevated in the manner that she got elevated? So this is a very big question that we need to ask. Now, in this case, apparently, we have to assume that the police and the prosecution did a good job, that they charge sheeted the offender, that the prosecution did the proper job in the trial. And it's only the judge who took a view, which is a deviant view, to let off the offender with just 1 year, whereas the trial court had given 3 years of punishment. Imprisonment. Now, the answer to these questions In the ministry, when I was in the Home Ministry for about almost 7 years, and I was leading the anti-human trafficking cell of the country, we had worked very closely with the judges in the various states, with the chief justices and the judges in the various states, by organizing colloquiums, as we have mentioned in the introduction. And in Bombay in particular, we worked with Justice Y.V. Chandrachud, who was then director of the Judicial Academy. And it was under his stewardship that we formulated a sensitization program, a brilliant book that all experts got together. I was member of that committee also. And this was at the instance of, it was released somewhere in 2015 or so by the Chief Justice of India, Justice Altamas Kabir. We did a lot of training. I've done a lot of sensitization. And interestingly, we took the police as the main plank of our training and the judiciary, but we also did not spare the prosecutors. So this was the kind of training that took place, as a result of which we got a huge number of complaints of cases of human trafficking. It was we had stopped practically arrest of women under the section of soliciting of women. Now, this kind of training and sensitization, better training is to better equip them. Interestingly, Justice Pushpa has a brilliant academic distinction. She's been a topper. She's been LLM, LLB, all that. But we have clearly realized that education and sensitivity are poles apart. It's a human nature to be sensitive. So education in our times, at least in my personal view, does not make you human. It's your upbringing that makes you human. And this particular lack of this quality of humanity. Now, the parameter that one would require to go through is, will anybody like anybody to touch their body even with clothes on? Is a question that a judge should ask of herself. If it is not acceptable to her, it is not acceptable for anybody else. There is no inadequacy in the law. In the frame of law, in the wording that have been used, there is no inadequacy. Unless you say that the lawmakers did not presume that people will be wearing clothes or not wearing clothes, and therefore skin to skin contact is what is applicable. This is no presumption. This is no presumption that it to the other side. Now, we also have this, I think in 2005, the Supreme Court passed a directive that there must be impact assessment of judicial pronouncements. Now, this is something that has not been observed ever. Now, impact assessment of particularly new laws, or when you're amending a law, we need to look at what has happened. How is it that justice has been denied? And for what reasons? Is it because of training, lack of training? Or is it because of absence of infrastructure? You want to do in-camera trial, you don't have the necessary facilities, you don't have IT infrastructure, etc., etc. These are all supposed to be encompassed in the impact assessment of the judicial process pronouncements. And therefore, this is how there was a direction by the Supreme Court very clearly to follow up on new laws and to follow up on where amendment of laws are taking place. Now, National Judicial Academy, of which we have been very closely I've been working very closely with the judicial academies as well as with the honorable judges of the various high courts. And we have done our own trainings in the NJA. Now there, we have seen that the curriculum is there. There is a curriculum for training and sensitization of judges. But you know, on issues of women and children, they are part of the overall training program. There is no standalone training program on issues of women and children. This is what, it cannot be generic. It has to be gender-centric. It has to take the differential needs of both men and women while adjudicating the cases. The last point I also want to say is that, you know, there is a tendency to put women where we have to deal with women's issues and children's issues. assuming there's a great degree of sensitivity. I think this is a complete myth. This is a complete myth. I have seen very, very sensitive male judges and male officers, male police officers, whoever it may be. This shows that women, as much as men, even in today's times, are in the grip of patriarchy. In the grip of patriarchy, where they believe that they have to be with the side of those patriarchs and they won't take a view independent of them. And therefore, this myth has also got to be broken. So with these few words, I would like to hand the mic back to you, Mr. Goyal. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Bhamati, for giving very, very strong words. And one point only which I would like to highlight is, she said that whether any woman with the clothes on would like that anyone can touch her, any age, any woman, child or elder, anyone. And she raised the same question to the Honorable Judge, whether she would like to be touched, if anybody would like to touch in that inappropriate manner. Thank you very much, Ms. Mahamati, for giving views. Now I would like to invite my next guest, and she is Honorable Justice Anjana Prakash. Honorable Justice Anjana Prakash is the former judge of Patna High Court. She hails from Rohini, now in Jharkhand, earlier in Bihar, and she is proud to be a Bihari. She is a senior advocate now practicing in Supreme Court of India. She graduated from Patna Women's College. She joined legal profession in 1982 and worked as junior to her father-in-law, the eminent lawyer late Braj Kishore Prasad, for almost 10 years. During this period, she was trained in criminal law, which was his area of specialization, and therefore inherited the legacy. She has also had the good fortune of working with other distinguished advocates such as Sri V.R. Manohar, Sri Ram Jethamalani, Sri Rajendra Singh, Sri Shanti Bhushan, which has been a huge learning experience for her and helped to enhance her personality and knowledge of law. In 2004, Patna High Court, in its history for the first time, designated lady lawyers as the senior advocate, and she was one of the two who were designated. In 2009, she was appointed as the judge of Patna High Court. She was the sole member from the Eastern region of India of a study group invited by the government of the United States of America in 1999 to visit USA to study the judicial reforms and administration, juvenile justice, law relating to women, prison administration, laws relating to street children. She retired in 2016. She is a regular invitee by Doordarshan, AIR, and various TV channels for panel discussions. And now this is our second time and for media conference with Lal Goyal also. Welcome, Honorable Justice Anjana Prakash, on our show. Honorable Justice Anjana Prakash, you have heard what Ms. Bhamati IAS has mentioned in her opening remark. And she is very clear in one point, ki how this definition or the skin to skin has come in the law, whether it is was there or not there, but the sensitivity should has to be there. And when already it was decided by the parliament, the law has been enacted, and law is very, very clear in all aspects why this type of judgment has come. And not only one, there are three judgments in, I think, in 1 week's time, on almost similar in the same way. Now, we would like to know, you being the Honorable Judge of Bihar, Patna High Court earlier, and you know the working of the courts and especially the high courts far more than any one of us. We would like to know from you the sexual harassment, skin-to-skin contact. Honorable Justice Anjana Prakash, please.
Thank you, Mr. Goyal. Thank you, Madam Bhamati. Actually, you've raised a very important question, Bhamati, where you said, you know, about sensitization and whether the judgment reflects lack of sensitization. Now, I'm not very sure, you know, whether it is lack of sensitization or misappreciation of law. I would think, you know, I would think that actually the way she's looked at the law is not correct. I would think like that. Of course, I mean, everybody has their own viewpoints. As judges also, you're supposed to have a viewpoint. And I would think that it was a incorrect way of looking at it. I agree that, you know, sensitization is required in every sphere of life. It is not only gender, it is caste, everything, you know, the way you treat other people, the way you treat, you know, your own staff, etc. You know, you need to be sensitive. There is no two views about it. But the point is, when you look at the scheme of POXO, what is exactly that as a lawyer would argue, both for both, you know, for the defense as well as for the prosecution? For this, you know, you need to really know the law. As I see it, you know, there are three categories of sexual assault or prevention of child abuse where POXO is concerned. One is penetration, when it is actually penetration, which enjoins a punishment of not less than 7 years. Then there is aggravated penetrative sexual assault, which is also aggravated in the sense that if somebody is in control of the victim concerned, then it is not less than 10 years. So the sentence is enhanced. The second category, sexual assault, where again the sentence is not less than 3 years. And then section 9 is aggravated sexual assault, which is not less than 5 years. Now the third category is sexual harassment. So where three categories are concerned, sexual harassment would come at the lowest rung, where there would be no physical contact, no contact as such. The second category is when there is a contact. And the third is when there is penetration. And here where the judge heard, I would think, was, you know, when she misinterpreted sexual assault to mean that there was to be skin to skin contact. Now, when we read this section closely, we see whoever with sexual intent touches the vagina, penis, anus, or breast of the child, or makes the child touch the vagina, penis, anus, or breast of such person or any other person, I'll stop here, or does any other act with sexual intent which involves physical contact without penetration is said to commit sexual assault. Nowhere does the section say that there has to be a skin-to-skin contact. Obviously, physical contact would mean anything. Mm. Be, you know, while you're wearing your clothes. And when you look at the scheme of POXO, then you realize, you know, that there is a different category where skin-to-skin contact is concerned. And that is penetration. But here, you know, it comes midway between sexual harassment and penetrative assault. So this is somewhere midway. So a person could be wearing clothes and yet be in physical contact. You could still touch the penis or the anus or whatever and abuse the person. So there, I think, you know, the judge made a mistake by saying that only unless there is skin to skin contact, the person cannot be convicted under the sexual assault. Now, the point is whether the judge erred or not and how we look at it. See, as human beings, you cannot forget this fact that a judge is also a human being and therefore fallible. Now, because we have a hierarchy of courts, so therefore, if a high court judge has made a mistake, the proper way of looking at it is that a revision would go before the Supreme Court and the Supreme Court would set it aside. This is the proper way, you know, of a judicial administration, because every judge makes a mistake. No matter how good he is, you know, every judge makes a mistake at some point in time, in the sense that you may have different views and your judgment may be overturned. So, you know, just, you know, I don't know whether here the judge was, you know, because of lack of sensitivity, she did this, or because it was an incorrect judgment. If it was an incorrect judgment, then the proper thing for the person who's aggrieved would be to go to the Supreme Court. This is how I would look at it, you know, because after all, a high court judge is it's a constitutional post. You have to honor that constitutional post by saying, you know, that yes, if you've made a mistake, you made a mistake. It's an incorrect, you know, application of law. Day in and day out, every judicial officer, every lawyer sees the kinds of blatant mistakes that judges make, sometimes lawyers also make in their arguments. So we see this day in and day out, you know, that is why, you know, there are so many judgments which are contrary, decided contrary to the High Court judgments. So can it be said, you know, that it is because of lack of sensitization that the judge has made, you know, an incorrect appreciation? And just because it is a gender issue, therefore one would think, you know, in terms of sensitization, sensitization would be required everywhere, because when you're required to do justice, you're required to be sensitive to the issue. Day in and day out, and where, you know, where I am concerned, I'm a criminal lawyer. So therefore I understand, you know, sensitivity, this lack of sensitivity in every sphere, in every case. Now, the second thing is, you know, a great, you know, objection has been raised against the judge by saying that she has said somewhere, you know, it is a minor offense. As though minor offense means something which is a minor event. One must understand the legal parlance, the legal, you know, the legal lingo, one would say, you know, a minor offense is, every offense is graded according to the punishment that it entails. Now, sexual harassment, it entails, you know, a lower punishment, even though I would think it is not a lower punishment, because it only gives discretion to the judge where sexual harassment is concerned. The punishment is up to 3 years, whereas sexual assault begins from not less than 3 years. So the judge can still convict a person under sexual assault and convict the person for 3 years. The judge can convict the person under sexual harassment and give him 3 years. So either way, it is, you know, the way the judge said was a minor offense. It only meant, you know, by gradations of the punishments that had been enlisted in the code. I would look at it like this. And Bhamati, I'm you're right, you know, where Judicial Academy, even I am a frequent, you know, visitor of the Judicial Academy most of the time as a resource person. And I understand, you know, when you say that no sensitization programs are held for gender, you know, sensitization as such, no special programs. Then I slightly disagree with you. Whenever we talk about, you know, sensitization there at the Judicial Academy, the course used to be divided, you know, in different categories. And the gender issue would also be there. The caste issue would also be there. But primarily, I would say even then, you know, that you have to be sensitive to the case that comes before you, irrespective of anything. A judge has to be sensitive if he has to do justice. Just as any human being has to be justice in every sphere of life. Otherwise, you'll never be correct. All that I wish to say for the present.
Okay. Thank you very much, Honorable Justice Anjana Prakash. And she has made one point which I would like highlighted, that the judge has to be sensitive for each and everything, not only for gender specific, but for everything. If he or she is sensitive, the judge is sensitive, then the judgments will be fair and it will look like that the justice has been done. Thank you very much, Honorable Justice Anjana Prakash, for giving your views. Now, I would like to invite my next guest, and she is Advocate Kanishka Tyagi. Advocate Kanishka Tyagi is a practicing lawyer and a radio personality. She is currently heading Business Strategies Department of Legum Amicus, a young dynamic law firm based at Delhi. After graduating from Campus Law Center, Delhi University, Kanishka worked with a couple of law firms in Delhi. She joined Caden Boris, a global law firm, as partner in 2011. She handles matters and advises clients on corporate legal issues ranging from private equity, real estate, compliances to posh, etc. As a radio anchor, Kanishka has been representing sports shows during major sports events, including Delhi Commonwealth Games, Cricket World Cup 2019, etc. Advocate Kanishka is a regular contributor to law magazines and journals and regular speaker and guest faculty at conferences, seminars, law college, and has addressed a wide variety of audiences of various platforms on corporate legal issues. Being a sports advocate, Kanishka has a special interest in sports law and has worked with a number of sports persons, federations, and leagues in sports-related legal issues. Welcome, Advocate Kanishka Tyagi, on our show. Advocate Kanishka Tyagi, you have heard our earlier panelist, Ms. Bhamati IAS, as well as Honorable Justice Anjana Prakash. Now, we would like to know from you the sexual harassment, skin-to-skin contact, Advocate Kanishka Tyagi, please.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Mr. Goyal, for the kind words. And yes, I have heard Madam Bhamati and Madam Prakash, and I agree with both of them. Ma'am Bhamati is right that we need to sensitize our judges. In fact, all the stakeholders who have any role to play in dispensation of justice system in our country. And I also agree with Ma'am Prakash that we have to be a little objective and see analyze this judgment or its impact from legal perspective also, because as human beings can make mistakes. However, if I were to share my view on this, then one thing that must be noted here is that this particular person whom we are discussing here has rendered more than one judgment in a span of very few days. And in both the judgments, the observations that have been made are that we cannot identify these two particular acts as offenses under POCSO. Here we have to keep in mind that POCSO is a special enactment which has been enacted for protection of children, and it is a gender neutral act. And if we only discuss section 7 of POCSO, which defines sexual assault, however, POCSO does not define the word or the term assault. If we move to another legislation, which is IPC, which defines assault, then as per the definition given in Indian Penal Code, assault, in fact, does not even require physical contact. So even if there is apprehension of criminal force, then also the act will be deemed and will be seen as assault. So if we just consider this particular definition and import the impact of this definition into POCSO, then there is a way of looking at the definition of Section 7, sexual assault, as given in Section 7 of POCSO, that any act, firstly, which has been done with the intent, sexual intent, and which creates the apprehension of use of criminal force, whether the actual criminal force has been used or not. Here we also have to take into consideration the fact that here we're talking about children. So children see...
Here may I interrupt? It is something like, you know, section 307, where attempt is not physical, only an apprehension, you know, of actual injury is not, you know, the thing. The intent is enough to scare the person. The intent is enough, you know, to scare them. And here the words also used are intent, with the intent.
Absolutely correct. I completely agree that it's the intent which is the basic ingredient. Moving forward, other than intent, that such kind of judgments, one after the another, they also set a precedent. So when, as a presiding officer who's dealing with a case under a special enactment which has been enacted for protection of children who are not capable to form judgment, to form opinion, whether whatever is being done to them is good for them or bad for them. At times it may so happen that a child may not even understand what is happening to that person. And the offender may do it in a way which may not appear to the child as something dangerous or something harmful. Then what will we do in such situations? Also, in these two particular judgments, I'm ready to accept the fact that, okay, these incidents, just for hypothetical, I do not completely agree with that observation, that these incidents are of minor nature, and the term of imprisonment which has been provided under POCSO is not commensurate to the nature of the offense. All right. But still, there was an option a discretionary powers could have been used by the judge that these two offenses could have been identified as offense under Section 7 and offense under Section 9 of POCSO. And I don't know if lighter punishment could have been awarded or not, but still the defining of these two offenses within section 7 and 9, within confines of section 7 and 9 was necessary because these shall be used as precedents. That is fine that as lawyers, we have to understand that we can analyze a judgment only from the legal perspective and see whether the law was interpreted in right direction or not, in right way or not. And also, but we also have to see as individuals and as general people, lay persons, that what is the impact of that judgment on the society? What if I were to go to that 12-year-old girl and tell her that the person who did that act and you cried because of that act, you shouted and you ran out of that room, that person is not guilty of a certain kind of offense. How will I break that news to her? How will I share that with her? I don't know whether the person knows it or not. So we also have to understand and consider the impact of judgment, not only in the terms of that these judgments are by a high court of a country and these shall be followed as precedents, may be followed as judicial precedents by lower courts, but also the social impact of these decisions. That is why we are seeing that today sitting on this forum and discussing the impact of these judgments today. And that is why the suggestions are being made that we need to sensitivize our judges or anyone who's related to dispensation of justice system. So because number one, that these will maybe followed as judicial precedents. Number two, in my opinion, this is a special enactment and we are talking about children who are very sensitive and they need to be protected. They cannot protect themselves either physically or mentally also. And thirdly, at a larger level, every kind of decision has a social impact also. So for now, this is what I feel. I may add to it after the other panelists have.
Thank you very much, Advocate Tyagi, for giving your views. And she says that the judgments, whether right or wrong, is going to have a social impact in a long run. So her angle is the judgment has to be in such a way that it should not give an adverse impact, especially on the children who can't save themselves physically and mentally. Thank you very much, Advocate Tyagi. Now I would like to invite my next panelist, and she is Advocate Divya Goyal. Advocate Divya Goyal is the partner of Legum Amicus at New Delhi. After successfully completing her professional qualifications from Institute of Companies Secretaries of India, she worked with a company secretaries firm in New Delhi, where she got extensive exposure in structuring of business, corporate and commercial advisor and secretarial and other regulatory and legal compliances. She did her law from Delhi University. She subsequently, along with other partners in India and UAE, co-founded full-service corporate legal law firm Legum Amicus at New Delhi and expanded her practice base to include real estate, posh, and other litigations. Advocate Divya has extensively represented corporate clients before district courts, high court, national company law tribunal, and handled various matters, including recovery matters, criminal complaints, company and insolvency applications, and several other matters. She has executed and advised both foreign and domestic companies on transactions related to private equity investments, real estate acquisitions, corporate restructuring, arrangements, commercial contracts, and secretarial matters. Advocate Divya has served as external members on internal committees of various corporate houses under POSH Act. Welcome, Advocate Divya Goyal. Advocate Goyal, you have already heard the earlier panelist, Ms. Bhamati, Honorable Justice Prakash, as well as Advocate Tyagi. Now, we would like to know from you, the sexual harassment, skin-to-skin contact. Advocate Divya Goyal, please.
Thank you, Mr. Goyal, for inviting me again and being a part of this panel. Thank you, Madam Bhamati, for your experienced views. And thank you, Madam Prakash. I'm really delighted to be a part of the panel, which has you again. Thank you very much. Thank you, Kanishka. So many different people with so many different views. So is the decision given by Justice Pushpa. Some people are saying that touching or pressing of a clothed body of a child did not amount to sexual assault. But other views are that this is a classic example of incorrect application of the law and reeks of judicial insensitivity to the larger issue of child abuse. And some are also of the view that this may be lack of sensitization. Some are saying that making skin-to-skin contact as an essential element for sexual assault, giving these comments, the learned judge has stirred a hornet's nest. And if we start interpreting laws in such narrow fashion tomorrow, we may see that an accused is not punished for rape because he used protection. And also, usage of gloves.
Excuse me, Advocate Goel, please speak a bit loudly. Your voice is a bit feeble. Yeah, loudly, please. Thank you.
Is it better now?
Yes, yes, better.
All right. Yes, so I was talking about the views of different people, that some have different views, some have some other views. Some are saying that this is lack of sensitization. Some are saying that this is an individual's view, point of view. And a group of people, I heard saying that they would not be surprised if criminals took this as a precedent to seek protection against all cases where physical contact is required to invoke the necessary presence of skin-to-skin contact to constitute touch. But my point was to, what about those children? Victims of child sexual abuse can face immediate and long-term psychological consequences that can impact their normal physical and mental development. These may range from anxiety to depression and maybe other issues like low self-esteem, poor body image, and much more. And what must be considered that childhood is the most important time for any individuals. You are in the process of becoming a full-fledged adult and your normal development gets impacted because of such incidents. So what either lack of sensitization or a person's view or, interpreting the law as you want to. But before, I think, giving any kind of decision, any kind of judgment, once everyone, whosoever is in that position, should think of those children who are facing such abuse. And another serious point to remember is that seriousness of offense was discussed while passing the skin-to-skin judgment. In my understanding, doing anything to the child, even seeing the child with sexual intent, is serious enough to invite the most serious of consequences. And I read a quote by a sex education trainer a couple of days back, and this comment is made by a woman who herself as a child was sexually assaulted. The comment goes like this: because you know what, they didn't even need to take my clothes off to violate me. And a layer of cloth means nothing when you take away someone's consent. And this comment just very wonderfully summarizes what can be deemed as sexual harassment or sexual assault. And in my views, there are two essential ingredients for an act to constitute offense of either sexual harassment or sexual assault. So it is, of course, as we discussed, the first and the foremost is that the act should have been committed with sexual intent. And secondly, the act must have been done without the consent of the victim. So if there is an act with sexual overture and it has been done without obtaining the consent of the victim, then the person who has committed such offense should be punished as having committed sexual harassment and sexual assault. Once this is established, then it will be seen whether it can be categorized as one of the various offenses of sexual nature under law. And also, there's one more point that I really want to discuss, that this whole thing, we must see from the other angle, that suppose if the child in this case was a male child, then what? Then by this narrow interpretation, we could not have been in a position, I think, to punish the offender at all. Because if As per my limited understanding, under IPC, the sections punishing sexual offences are written based on assumption that the woman is the victim. So in such a case, the offender in this case would only have been punished either for kidnapping or for trespass. So if I'm considering that the offender in this particular example instance, if I consider that the offender is the relative of a male child, maybe his legal guardian or a parent, so in such a case, there is absolutely no possibility of trespass because the child stays with that relative, and also no possibility of kidnapping because the offender would have the legal guardianship. Then if a man or a woman who is the legal guardian of a boy who is under the age of 12 years touches a male child without removing his clothes, the offender would have walked scot-free because there will be no punishment at all. So to call this interpretation narrow is narrow because this interpretation totally violates the objective with which a special enactment of POXO has been enacted.
Thank you very much, Advocate Goyal. And she said she has raised one point. In case if the child is a male child below 12 years and if he will be offended, assaulted sexually, according to this judgment, the offender will be scot-free or will be treated in a kidnapping, or even she says not kidnapping if the offender is a guardian of the child, male child. So there are lots of controversies, lots of interpretations of the law. Now I would like to invite thank you very much, Advocate Goyal, for giving your views. I would definitely come back to you with a question. Now I would like to go to my next guest, and he's Mr. Srijan Mishra. Mr. Srijan Mishra is presently research assistant at Maharashtra National Law University, Nagpur. He completed his LLM in Energy and Telecommunication Laws from National Law University, Nagpur, and BLLB honors from National Law University and Judicial Academy, Assam. He is also pursuing his PhD from Maharashtra National Law University, Nagpur, in the field of narcotic laws and education policy. Mr. Srijan has participated and presented papers in several national and international conferences. He has also attended and participated in international events like Critical Legal Conference organized by University of Kent, United Kingdom in 2016, World Intellectual Property Organization India Summer School in 2017, and the William Coates with the International Commercial Arbitration Moot Vienna in the year 2018. He has also experience of closely working with the Center of Child Rights at National Law University, Assam, as volunteer, and has been involved in organizing many national conferences and capacity building programs. Welcome, Mr. Srijan Mishra, on our show. Mr. Srijan Mishra, you are different among all the lots because you are from the academic side, although you are also a LLB, LLM, and you are pursuing your PhD in the law only. Now, definitely, we would like to know from you the views on this particular topic, that is sexual harassment, skin-to-skin contact. Mr. Srijan Mishra, please.
Thank you so much, sir, for having me in this program with such learned panelists. And it has been last an hour or so has been a learning exercise for me as well, after listening all of the learned panel members. So before I get into the other part of the judgment, the present issue, the skin-to-skin contact, has been discussed because of interpretation of Section 7 of the POXO Act. And while we see, as Anjana Prakash Madam has already pointed out, there are four different parts in which the section can be divided. And what the learned judge in this case did was, it went for a literal interpretation of the provision, which was not enough because, again, POXO is a protective legislation which has been enacted under Section Article 15(3) of the Constitution of India. And while interpreting such welfare legislations, I would like to point out once Justice Deepak Mishra, while hearing a case, pointed out that while interpreting such legislations, one has to be guided by color, content, and the context of statutes. The judge had to release himself from the chains of strict linguistic interpretation and pave the path that served the soul of legislative intent in the event. He should become a real constructive, creative, constructive judge. Now, if we see this idea of Justice Deepak Mishra, which he pointed out, we can see that the literal interpretation that the learned judge did in this case was not enough. While I agree with Anjana Madam that it is more of an incorrect judgment or incorrect interpretation of law, the fact that gender sensitization issue comes up because it was just not one individual case. There were a number of decisions that were followed. So that is why this issue of gender sensitization comes in. I feel that other than section interpretation of Section 7, there are a couple of more observations that the court did in the judgment. The judgment is very brief, but it is very significant. The observations that were made during in the judgment are more surprising because there is no doubt throughout the judgment that the individual accused here touched the child inappropriately. This was a fact that was established and was not countered by either party. And even after that, one of the observations of the court was, considering the stringent nature of punishment provided for the offense, in the opinion of this court, stricter proof and serious allegations are required. Now, this, as has been discussed before about the minor and major offense, this observation itself has narrowed down the scope of the intersection. Because it also sends a precedent and also gives an idea to the lower court judges and other high courts as well about the trends and the precedent that has been set by one individual high court. And this, when we say that stringent nature of punishment, because of this stringent nature of punishment, higher level of serious allegations are required. A child here has been sexually assaulted. What the child goes cannot be felt by anyone except the child. And maybe it might come out after some years that the child realizes what has happened to her. So the whole that aspect has to be taken into consideration while we are discussing this. And this particular observation, I found it very surprising coming to this in such a sensitive case that higher level of serious allegation is required to prosecute someone under Section 7 of POCSO. That was one surprising thing because when we talk about harsher consequences, it's been a long journey for the legal system and India as a country, as far as the protection of children from sexual offences is concerned. It's been a long road that we have travelled. And if you want to sensitise people, these judgments, even as far as sensitisation is concerned, just not about the judges or the police or anyone, even as an individual, we have to be very much concerned and sensitive towards such issues because this is a day-to-day activity that has happened. And I'm sure more than 90%, even 2015-16, national surveys also pointed out that more than 90% of cases were unreported. And there's a reason why these things were unreported, because whatever this happens in closed doors. And people are very much, because of family pressure or the stigma that has been attached, these are the ways we can remove those stigmas. These are the ways we can break that glass and give some comfort to that child. And they're narrowing down the scope. My personal opinion is that the major issue here is that we've narrowed down the scope of Section 7, which is a major concern here. Because earlier also, I'd like to refer a judgment of Delhi High Court in which Rakesh versus State of NCT of New Delhi, in which the court, as soon as the fact was established that the individual inappropriately touched the child, court did not even went into the fact that whether the touch was skin to skin or not. The fact was established that the individual here, that the culprit there, offender was did touch the child, press the breast, and the court did not even go into the fact that whether the touch was skin to skin or not, and the person was charged under Section 7. So another judgment of Ravi versus State, the court went to the extent of saying that catching hold of a child, hand of child survivor with sexual intent amounted to sexual assault. With even if you hold the hand of a child with sexual intent will be put under Section 7. So we see the courts have been working hard to expand the scope and to make sure that such things which happen in closed doors are not appreciated. And when such judgments come, I'm not saying that the learned judge here was not sensitized enough, because a number of NGOs have come out after the judgment and they've said that they've been following her since her trial, court days, and they've seen how meticulous she was during that time. So I think this is more of a misinterpretation that happened from the court side. And the scope has been narrowed down. And as far as touching is concerned, sir, one of the points that Goel madam has pointed out, that what if it was a boy? Now, because it was a girl, we're talking about the outraging the modesty of women? What if it was a boy? What would have the court's opinion then? So these are the parameters that we have to keep in mind while discussing such thing. And so the other thing is that the word touching, if we see, we have not defined in our legislations, but if we, for example, see the Sexual Offences Act of the United Kingdom, their sexual assault, when they've defined, they say, and I quote, that when a person commits an offence, if he intentionally touches another person, the touch is sexual, B does not consent to touching, and A does not reasonably believe that B consents. And this touching, they've gone on to the extent of bringing it into the under the expression penetration. So they have gone to that extent. And even so this is very small thing when we discuss that whether it is skin to skin contact or not, because the intent of legislation is clear. The idea behind the legislation is clear, to protect the children. And if we narrow down the scope altogether, it will not serve the purpose, and in fact will set a bad precedent for the lower courts also, and also will affect the individuals. I'm just not talking about the judges sitting on the bench, because I'm sure there are a number of, even I've read that there are a number of sensitization programs that keeps happening in Judicial Academy and other places. Even while working with the center, we also had a number of district judges and police officers that we helped in the capacity building programs. So such programs are happening, but even after that, one single judgment cannot, can be put as a whole, a blot on the judiciary in that sense. But I feel, again, I would agree to the point that it is more of a misinterpretation rather than issue of gender sensitization. Because if you observe the judgments, there are certain paragraphs that you'll find. And one mistake in the judgment was that knowingly or unknowingly, unfortunately, the name of the victim was repeated in one of the paras. So that again becomes a problem, and this was not expected to be part of a judgment. Earlier we have seen that the names have come out from media houses or individuals giving comments, but in the judgments the courts have been very sensitive as far as the name of the victim is concerned. So that also becomes a very important aspect. And so section 32 clarifies that the accused must rebut these presumptions beyond reasonable doubt rather than a preponderance of probabilities. Here what the learned judge concluded in the end was, because there was no fact to prove, no evidence to prove that whether the individual put his hand in the top or not, is not to be even dealt with. The fact that the individual pressed the breast of the child will itself amount, because the nature was sexual. If you see the facts, the individual took the girl to his house. Individual, when his mother came, the child's mother came, he told her that the child was not there. The mother started looking for the child and eventually found him in one of his rooms. So, and he also tried to, you pull down the salwar of the child. So all of these things itself are clear that the intention of the individual was not right. And it was not, I feel that bringing it down to the outraging modesty of the woman is not enough to ensure that such things does not happen in future. And moreover, also such judgments, when we talk about basic principle, one of the basic principles of criminal jurisprudence, when we talk about punishment for an offense, shall be proportionate to the seriousness of crime. When the facts have been established and no one has rebutted the fact that this individual was involved, the offense itself has become serious. And if we talk about proportionate, the punishment should be proportionate to the offense. We see that here everything was established, and it was only misrepresentation of Section 7 that has led to this whole issue of coming into skin-to-skin contact and physical.
I may be excused. My case is being taken up. I may be excused. Sorry. I may be excused.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
My case is being taken up.
Okay. 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 Yeah. Yeah. Please. Okay.
I only wanted to mention, madam, that I started my.
No, she her case has been taken up, so no, she
I
has
to. I just want to tell her something. One thing, just a second. I started my career in Ranchi, and I have met your father, not in the court for contempt, but otherwise. So I'm very happy to have met you on screen today.
You were in Ranchi.
I was in Ranchi. I started my career from Ranchi, but I was serving in the CADA, in which course I had a chance to meet your father. Honorable.
Oh.
Thank you so much.
So nice. This world is so small.
She is from Bihar.
Keep in touch. I'll take your phone number, Bhamati. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Where are you located?
Chennai.
Okay, we'll stop then. Okay. Bye.
Okay. Okay, thank you. In case if your case is over before 11:50, you can join again.
Thank you.
Okay, now I'm going to Ms. Bhamati. Thank you very much, Mr. Mishra, for giving your views. And we have to continue because Honorable Justice Prakash has to leave because she has a hearing right now. So what Mr. Mishra has raised, very pertinent points, and he says that it might be a case of misinterpretation. Okay, we will come to that point again. Thank you very much, Mr. Mishra, for giving your views. Now my question goes to Ms. Bhamati. Ms. Bhamati, what impact on the society this case is going to leave, according to you?
This is it leaves such a harmful psychological impact on the child and the immediate relations, the parents, the siblings. It's just look at the situation. This child has gone through the agony whenever she was violated till January 2021. You think she wouldn't have had any trauma? She would have gone for making statements before the police, all in uniform, and she would have been overwhelmed by the situations. And she did not know what was a bad touch. And now she realizes that this was something that was harmful to me. How will she face the society? How will she face her school, her friends in school? And you know, generally the tendency is, why did you go and take food from him? The blame will be on the child. Now, what kind of therapy that will be needed for a child? We have to tell her, it was not your mistake. It didn't happen because of you. He was the offender. Now, we do all these things. We do a lot of counseling. I don't know whether this child got the access to any kind of counseling. No, the point is the law which Madam read out is very clear in the law. Now, there is no mismatch between the facts of the case and the law. The point is also that we create a law to protect children, and we say it's misapplication of law, and therefore the child undergoes secondary victimization because of a law that is ostensibly created in the name of the protection of the child. Can we allow this to happen? Now, this judge, coming to the point, this judge has crossed all limits of fallibility. She has failed the test of fallibility. Because it's not just one judgment, the other judgment. In this case, it was a complete case of insensitization. There was no need to mention her name at all. There was no legal basis. There was no legal basis, not need. There was no legal basis. Now, can we question this judge? If the collegium is going to take a view on the judge, the question that they would ask is, you know, there are several precedent judgments, judicial pronouncements, which says that you cannot reveal the name of the child. Why did you not know about it? Assumption. Ignorance of law is no excuse for anybody, least of all for a judge. Now, she should have known that she should not have revealed the name of the child. So it's a clear case of misapplication of, without a mismatch between facts of the case and the law point, there was a misapplication of law. Clearly comes within the realm of lack of sensitivity. Now, let's look at the other two judgments that she has passed. I'm doing this because it says you can be fallible once, but you cannot be fallible again and again and again, given the fact that you have had people have testified that she was a meticulous judge and she did extremely well before. The point is, government, this was a movement, this was a women's movement in the 90s. When judgment was passed saying that if there is no resistance from the victim in case of rape, then, you know, it will not go in her favor. Now, repeatedly courts, and it has come within the framework of IPC to say that this is no parameter to judge that the victim is not innocent. No, it has been repeatedly pronounced by the Supreme Court and courts of high courts, etc., that this should not be deemed to that, you know, she was not trying to resist, and it actually amounted to consent. You see the other extreme there. So courts have, now the question that the collegium should ask is, Why did you pass? No, the question is not, the collegium is not going to look at the skin-to-skin contact alone. They have to read one judgment after the other that she has passed now and in the earlier also. We have to look at it holistically. What is the psyche of this person? There is something seriously wrong. It's a lack of knowledge. It's a lack of knowledge, therefore misapplication of law. It's a lack of sensitivity, lack of knowledge, and therefore misapplication of law. So all of this goes in a continuum. We cannot allow her to get abroad with this kind of view, in my point of view.
Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Bhamati. You have made a very strong point. Although I could not comment because nowadays the contempt of court can be issued anytime for anybody, and it is a very common practice in India, and she is still a honorable judge on the bench right now. Yes, after 12th of February, we don't know whether she will be in the High Court or revert back to the District Court. Then the matter will be different.
Mr. Goyal, that's why I made in my initial remark that this is an open discussion.
Yes, please.
I have nothing personal. I don't.
Yes, I understand. Now my question goes to Advocate Tyagi. Advocate Tyagi, do you think the collegium has not taken objections seriously, or was there some pressure when there was a judge? After all, you might be knowing, being an advocate, although I wanted to ask this question to the Justice Prakash, but she's not there. You might be knowing when a judge is elevated to the High Court, his or her best five judgments going to be sent to the collegium. They study those judgments, and then only he or she is going to be elevated. It means there were objections earlier. It means her five best judgments were not suitable for her in 2019 to be elevated, or 2018 or 17. But what happened in 1 year's time that she was elevated to the High Court by the collegium? Is it what the report says, even two members of the collegium objected. And one more thing. Always the practice is, you might be knowing, you being the advocates, that the concerned High Court judges who are now in the Supreme Court, their advice are always being taken about that particular judge whom they are going to elevate. Why it was happened? Don't you think Supreme Court collegium err in their decision or the judgment?
You rightly pointed out about contempt of court. Had I not been from legal fraternity, I would certainly have been more vocal.
No, then you would have faced more.
I'm not sure about that. Despite that, I'll still like to give, like my co-panelist, benefit of doubt. Maybe it's just, if I can use the word, poor understanding of law or poor interpretation of law rather than a predetermined mentality, just to not to define a series of acts as offenses under POCSO, because the punishment provided is more stringent. Just because punishment is more stringent, can you take away an act which clearly is within the confine of definition of that particular offense? Can you take away from there because the punishment is more stringent? Is that a valid ground? I don't know. But I cannot make a comment about Supreme Court's collegium, whether there was any pressure or not.
Advocate Tyagi, you are also a journalist. We are talking very freely. There is a media report. I am not talking from my side. You can Google search. You will find it is written very clearly. Two of the judges objected for her elevation. In spite of that, that's what I'm asking the procedure, that in 1 year's time, because the procedure says that the five best judgment which the judge himself or herself offer, that these are my five best judgment, on that basis only the elevation takes place. Now the elevation could not take place earlier because they found, the collegium found, that she is not suitable. And but what happened in 1 year's time that she was elevated? My only limited question to you is, in the collegium also, there are some party politics or favoritism. Is there or not?
See, I'll answer it. I'll try to, with best of my ability, that we are all at the end of the day human beings, and human beings have strengths and weaknesses both. Whether you talk about any layperson or a judge or collegium which comprises of individuals, so you cannot eliminate that possibility of some sort of external pressures. I'm not just talking about this particular case, generally also.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Advocate Tyagi. I got the answer. Now my question to you, Advocate Goyal, is what Honorable Justice Prakash said, that it might be the misinterpretation. And she says the procedure is if any judgment which is wrong, the Supreme Court can stay or can reverse. Why so much harsh action taken by Supreme Court? Why? What was the need? After all, at that time, there was one judgment when the Supreme Court decided, and they immediately withdrawn the recommendation on one judgment. I am sure there might be many judgments of many judges who are had been turned out or reversed by the Supreme Court. Don't you think Supreme Court was harsh on this particular judge? Otherwise, there is a provision. If she would have become permanent after 12th of February, the 13th of February, then only removal can be by the impeachment. And there is a condition in impeachment about the incapability. But till now, as per my research says, not a single judge has been impeached on the basis of incapability. So my point is, don't you think that Supreme Court was also harsh? And the way it was mentioned in the court by the Attorney General was oral. Otherwise, generally, it is something to be this thing. He just mentioned oral and immediately suo motu, and they have stayed. That is fine. But immediately they issued a letter to the government not to permanent. Do you think it was also harsh against the judge? She might have. It might be that it is her knowledge says that it is not. It comes under 354, not on POSCO. It is common. Judge can have.
It may be harsher, but as ma'am also said, that this judgment, particularly this judgment, has a large social impact. You know, there might be one reason that this should not happen, this should not be habitual, this should not happen again and again. Sometimes, you know, let's not discuss, let's not talk about the Supreme Court only. In our general lives also, sometimes we have to become harsher for normal small things, because there are reasons behind that. This actually has a larger social impact, and it this is why we are discussing it here, isn't it? Why are we not discussing all the judgments, all whatever is happening around us? We are not discussing. Why are we discussing this here is because it actually has a deeper impact. Am I right?
Okay.
So this must have been the intention.
So that's why Supreme Court has done this. Okay, thank you very much, Advocate Goyal. Now my last question goes to Mr. Mishra. Do you think this law was misused very often? Because there is no proof. If a child cannot give any proof, and the parents of the child or the guardian of child can misuse, I am not blaming the child, can misuse. And that's why she was not inclined to punish in POCSO. She has converted in 354. That's what I want to know, Mr. Mishra, that it might be one of the reasons that she has taken this. As you mentioned, that she was very brilliant and her earlier judgments were very good. You mentioned it. So I'm asking, I'm giving the benefit to doubt that it might be that she has only, because she found that this is a misuse of the this particular act by the adults or by the guardians of the child. And that's why she has not given this thing. Mr. Mishra, please.
Sir, very, very likely you've pointed out. Though I personally feel that this might not be the case, though every legislation that is there, there are, you know, positives and negatives attached to it. But in this particular case, I don't think so, because as I pointed out, the court has categorically mentioned that there was no doubt as far as the touching of to the girl is concerned, or the circumstances that were, you know, happening around that time, that he did not inform the mother and all of that. So here, there is no doubt as far as the facts were concerned. That is why I pointed out specific observation that the judge did about the stricter punishment. So that is very important. So I don't think this was because of that. Oh, but I feel, yes, that is one of the points.
Okay, thank you very much. paucity of time, so I have to close. Thank you very much. And today you have seen the judgment has created a controversy all over India. And it has to be, because we do not want the children should suffer. As our panelists have mentioned, what condition of the child, although now she, I was told that she is now about 21, 22 years old, but condition of that 10 years torture, and now again, from this judgment till the time Supreme Court has stayed, in those 8-10 days or whatsoever time, how much trauma she might have faced and facing. And in this has to be stopped. Might be that the judge has given the judgment on her own decision. But what Supreme Court has done also is exemplary, because the Supreme Court has stayed, and not only stayed, and written to the government for withdrawing her permanent judgeship. And that is very important, that all the judicial, whether judges of high courts or even the subordinate courts, they should understand, after all, justice only not to be delivered, it is to be seen. And that is what we have to see, and we have to see the impact, social impact on the society. And our society is very culturally rich. We should not come out with any type of such type of judgment, which will not only break, but humiliate and insult our own culture. Thank you very much for joining us. And today's program has been live telecasted by V4 News, Global TV, V4 Stream, Malnadu TV, Newsgaon se Samvad Saroka News, as well as it was shown live on Facebook and YouTube. And our endeavor is to bring to you every day a new topic. And tomorrow our topic is women and politics. And our panelists are Dr. Rajiv Anand, Senior Psychiatrist, Mumbai, Advocate Manjula Rao, Senior Advocate, Bombay High Court, Mumbai, Ms. Carol Andarde, Senior Journalist, Media Educator, Dean, St. Paul's Institute of Communication Education, Mumbai, Ms. Sanjana Sheth, Generalist, New Delhi, Advocate Aarti Nimbalkar, Designated Partner, S. Ashwini Kumar and Company LLP, Mumbai. So please tune in tomorrow at 10:30 a.m. for media conference with Lal Goyal. Thank you very much, Ms. Bhamati, for joining us. And I must give a special thanks to you that although you were initially not in the panel, but today morning, because of the topic, such seriousness of topic, you wanted to come. That is a very, very good thing. We must appreciate, because you are also one of the signatory for creating the awareness about this particular judgment in the country. And that is what is required today in our democratic country. Thank you very much, Ms. Bhamati, for joining us. Thank you very much, Honorable Justice Anjana Prakash, although you are busy in your case, but thank you very much. Thank you very much, Advocate Kanishka Tyagi. Thank you very much, Advocate Divya Goyal. And thank you very much, Mr. Srajan Mishra, for joining us. And thank you all the viewers for watching this very, very enlightened discussion and topic of today's. Thank you very much.